So, the quest for the Teraflop supercomputer to operate at a peak speed of 10 to the 12 floating point operations per second is over a decade old. By 1995, a Teraflops computer at a $30 million supercomputer price may exist. In the last few years, more progress has been made in exploiting parallelism than ever before. This is the nature of exponential increases. You can forget all that came before. Many factors have enabled this progress. First, fast, cheap CMOS microprocessors taken from workstations. Second, entrepreneurial companies. Third, scalable computers based on interconnecting 1,000 processor memory pairs to constitute massive parallelism. Fourth, system programmers, including compiler writers, to utilize scalable computers. Fifth, application programmers and computational scientists who have discovered parallel apps that can be scaled large enough to cover the overhead that occurs when dividing work into independent tasks. And finally, federal funders. 80% of the five-year, $6.6 billion plan for the High Performance Computing and Communication Initiative is aimed at the teraflop. Virtually every computer company is offering or developing some form of scalable computer based on powerful distributed CMOS micros. These range from specifically constructed computers to interconnected headless workstation clusters. Both IBM and Cray Research have stated that scalable computers could replace limited scalability multiprocessors with 8 to 16 processors as the main line of mainframes and supercomputers. Cray's T3D is the first scalable that shows promise to compete with the super. Let me begin by outlining the structure of my talk. First, I will cover the progress to date. Next, I will discuss three ways of implementing scalability: machine size scalability, problem scalability, and generation or technology scalability. I will talk about the components that go into building scalable computers and the high-level computer structures that form from them. Then I will compare the scalable multiprocessor and the scalable multicomputer that appear almost identical from a distance. They differ by what's in hardware versus what's in software. However, with parallelism, the performance or loss thereof is in the detail, and this will remind us of the RISC-CISC debate. Next, I will project how I see scalables developing and the difficulties we will encounter. Finally, I'll posit that by building good networks, ordinary workstations may avoid many of these problems while providing everything scalable multi-computers offer at no additional cost. Then everyone will have a massively parallel computer. Let's look at the progress in parallelism. Ambo's law clearly showed the need for extremely pure parallel code. However, no one believed that the parallelism was going to be so difficult to exploit. Based on writing code for vector supercomputers, which is hard, requires training and the right apps, massive parallelism is massively hard, requiring an even more select set of problems and very carefully designed computers. Traditional supercomputer apps are rarely portable to MPPs. The search for problems that can run at a teraflop using scalable computers is a constant battle with nature, algorithms, and programs. While the talk will implicitly assume numeric apps, large-scale commercial applications such as back-end database servers and transaction processors may be more amenable to solution, but the journey will be just as hard. Parallelism is a journey, not a state that one arrives at. Several years ago, a computational scientist at the European Long Range Weather Forecasting Center projected a teraflop in 2000, beginning with 50 flops in 1950. This half century of progress amounts to a compound rate of 58% per year. Such growth could continue for several decades into the 21st century. I only make 3 to 6 year forecasts based on the next generation of components. 60% per year means quadrupling in 3 years. 60% is exactly Moore's law that describes the yearly increase in the number of transistors on a semiconductor chip. 60% is the rate that microprocessors have improved for almost a decade. In 1987, the Gordon Bell Prize administered by the IEEE was established to reward progress in parallelism to those who have exploited parallel computers and achieved extraordinary speed-up, performance, and cost-effectiveness. Three computational scientists at Sandia won the prize in 87 by demonstrating speedups of 600 on three problems using a 1,000-node N-cube multicomputer that ran at speeds comparable to an ordinary vector supercomputer. Their work was the first real demonstration of scalability. They showed that if each computer node had more memory, a factor of 1,000 speedup would have been possible. They proposed memory-constrained scaling. This assumes a user always wants to run the largest possible data set without overflowing memory to get the highest operation rate. While the operation rate in a node increases, the computational time grows at least linearly, but more likely like the cube of the problem size. 1991 and 92 entrants used 192 and 800 geographically distributed workstations. The 92 entrant was doing genome sequencing. 1992 entrants had real application performance, or RAP, of 60 gigaflops, or one-half the 128 gigaflop peak advertising performance, or PAP, on Thinking Machines CM5. In July 1993, Japan's numerical wind tunnel ran apps at 116 gigaflops on a multicomputer, which is turning out to be the prototype of the VPP500. Progress over the 5 years from 1987 has been an astounding factor of 133 for a compound growth of 2.65 per year. This is made up of Moore's law, using more expensive machine with a peak of 128 versus 40 gigaflops, a more efficient compiler, finding more parallel apps, and evolved programming. Performance per dollar has not increased since 1990. In 1992, the best performance per dollar was with a system costing $50,000, consisting of 32 computer nodes attached to a workstation and providing about four times the cost effectiveness of a large MPP. Assuming continued progress of 2.65 per year, a factor of 16 is still required to get a RAP of a teraflop. What's the phenomena that makes massive parallelism possible? Massive problems. The unconstrained size LINPACK benchmark illustrates the need for large problem sizes in order to achieve high performance in both the 1,000-node CM5 and the four-vector processor SX3 supercomputer. Each computer costs about $30 million. The CM5 achieves about 45% of PAP, or 60 gigaflops, for an order 55,000 matrix, and drops to half this for order 24,000. The SX3 achieves about 90% of PAP, or 23 gigaflops, for order 6,400, and runs at half speed for order 800. An order 55,000 matrix requires 24 gigabytes of data and 8 minutes to move with a 50 megabyte per second disk system. One concludes that for matrices of order 20,000, the two compute at the same speed, which relegates MPP to only very large, long-running problems in order to cover overhead. To increase the efficiency of MPP, the best way is to reduce the number of processing elements. Runtime increases as a cube of the matrix order, so to run at peak, a run lasts a half hour. I posit there exists a problem that can be made sufficiently large such that any network of computers can run efficiently given enough memory, searching, and work. But this problem may be unrelated to any other problem. Given the recent progress and optimism that many problems appear to be parallel, one might conjecture most parallel problems can be scaled up to run on any arbitrary network of computers given enough memory and work. I challenge theoreticians to show how efficiently a given algorithm will run on a given computer. Getting parallel programs to run efficiently will continue to be an art for many, many years. Now let's look at the three scalabilities. Machine size scalability, generation scalability, and problem machine scalability. A size scalable computer is one that is designed from a few identical components with no bottleneck component. The computer can be expanded incrementally over its scaling range and deliver incremental performance for some applications. A system is indefinitely scalable if it can exist at a size larger than anyone's budget. Scalability has been a design goal of computer architects for three decades. Supers are all shared memory multiprocessors that scale to 16, mainframes to 8, and multiple micros or multis to 32. A generation scalable computer is one that can be re-implemented with faster next generation components such that no new bottlenecks are created, such that apps will run effectively with no rewriting or, hopefully, no recompilation. All successful previous generation computers have been generation or technology scalable for at least a decade. So far, no scalables have been compatible for 5 years. This incompatibility guarantees the non-existence of a software market. Problem machine scalability is an objective measure of the problem scale in terms of a particular scalable computer. It is the ability of a problem and algorithm mapped into a program that exists at a range of scales that run effectively or efficiently at varying computer scales. That is, we have a runtime space measured by problem scale and machine scale. Problem scalability is ultimately constrained by memory size. From this runtime space, measures of speedup and efficiency determine whether we are happy and declare a problem to be scalable or not. Let's look at a limited scalability computer, the multi, and why it's limited. As a multiprocessor, all processors see a single shared memory that is managed by a single operating system. The multi is the most efficient and effective computer we have. In 85, when we introduced the Encore Multimax, I predicted that this structure would be mainline computers for everything after 1990. Every manufacturer from PCs to large servers that replace mainframes now use this simple structure. Furthermore, it is clear that if we go forward, single chips will hold multiple microprocessors. Various processor and memory modules connect to the bus. The structure is efficient and works because of the snooping cache that provides fast access to keep the processor busy by holding data that would otherwise clog the bus. It snoops on bus transfers to keep a coherent memory. Unfortunately, the bus can't be extended indefinitely, and buses have limited bandwidth and almost never scale for a decade. In 1994, large multis have bus speeds of about 1 gigabyte per second. By taking a uni or a multiprocessor computer as the computer node building block and interconnecting these nodes by a switch, we can build a computer that can grow indefinitely. When you connect an arbitrary number of computers, the scalability problem is now transferred to the switch designer, OS builders, and compiler writers. To be generation scalable, bandwidth, delay times, communication overhead must all improve at 60% per year, and this looks tough. All of the scalables have this structure. But the real difference is whether they are multiprocessors with a single memory or multicomputers like workstations on a LAN that communicate with one another by passing messages. This graph shows why scalable computers have become important. $30 million supercomputers are on an evolutionary path to achieve 1 teraflop by 2000. $30 million worth of scalable computers provide a factor of 8 higher PAP than supers. Computers are named according to purchase price. Thus, a computer costing more than $50 million is an ultracomputer. By spending $250 million, a teraflop could be reached in 1995, but this would be foolish, since waiting for the next generation accomplishes the same end and will be substantially more useful. By 1990, Bell Prize apps ran above the peak of supers at about half the MPP's PAP. What about an ideal scalable? First, PAP, that is, peak advertising performance, attracts users. PAP provides hope to parallelize apps. A computer should be continuously upgradable from 1 to 1,000 with correspondingly scalable I/O and switching. It should have the performance per dollar that approaches workstations and be available in the same time scale. Given the number of nodes, fault tolerance and high availability are essential. General purposeness is critical for economic viability. In other words, the ideal scalable computer must be able to handle a wide range of scalable parallel apps, including a workload from sequential to parallel, from small to large job size, run times, and response times. All grains of parallelism need to be supported. Next, the components and networks must be generation scalable to evolve over at least a decade to support compatibility of apps among generations with no rewriting or recompiling. Lastly, the ideal scalable computer might be distributable or spatially scalable beyond a single room to include a campus. Workstations come the closest to fulfilling this part of the ideal, but alas, the limited factor is the switch. I hope I can convince just one MPP company to abandon beheading workstations. Why not use what comes out of the workstation box, develop fast switches, and to concentrate on software? All forms of parallelism are similar. A series of computational grains start, communicate with one another, and then come together, and most often they repeat. Performance is a function of the length of the computational grain, how much the threads communicate, and the overheads to establish, to start, and to stop the threads. The beginning time to schedule a new computational thread and synchronize the completion of threads at end time is pure overhead and can grow as log of the number of processors. This argues for hardware like Cray's T3D to run fine-grained apps. Three intercommunication time parameters are inherent in distributed computers and must be measured. First, latency, the time between when an app sends a message and when it is received by the app in another node. Second, overhead, or time lost when sending and receiving a message. Third, bandwidth. I like Culler, Karp, and Patterson's log P model that names the three: latency, overhead, and gap, or the interval between messages determined by bandwidth. Assuming a computer that has adequate bandwidth and that latency can be hidden by doing other work resulting in sloth, processor overhead is important because the opportunity for work is lost. For a given app, the communication network latency that cannot be covered within the grain plus processor message overhead determine the delivered power, assuming there's no scheduling and synchronization overheads. Architects are concerned with bandwidth and latency, but the performance is lost in message passing software overhead that is rarely measured. For simplicity, it doesn't matter where you lose the time. Overheads that come from scheduling, synchronization, deciding what to do next, communicating, or sloth that comes from waiting to communicate due to limited bandwidth or having a long path through the switch. Overhead and sloth kill efficiency and make parallelism not attractive. These hardware and software details determine the efficacy of a given MPP. Let's define degrees of granularity that come from the combined overhead and sloth in a computational thread. Initialization, scheduling, synchronization, and inter-thread latencies that cannot be covered with computation and communication overhead. For a thread efficiency of 50%, the thread computation must equal the thread overhead and sloth. For efficiencies of 90%, computational communication must be increased by a factor of 9. A fine-grained problem with 100 operations per grain operating on 100 megaflops computers can only tolerate 1 microsecond of thread overhead to still run at half peak power. If we use a LAN and workstations that have overhead of, say, 1,000 microseconds per message, the grain size has to be increased to 100,000 operations to run at 50% efficiency. I define medium grain as 1,000 operations per grain. For successful parallel processing, grains need to be as long as possible to cover overhead and sloth. Unrolling loops and using multiple virtual processors are techniques to extend grain length. Fox defines a domain decomposition problem like heat transfer that is solved in a uniform space and time to be synchronous. Let's look at one. A physical structure is mapped into an array of distributed computing nodes. The computation for a point is carried out by averaging 6 adjacent points. As the spatial points are updated, values are moved to other computing nodes. This single time step constitutes a thread or grain. If S cubed points are packed into each computing node, then 7 S cubed operations are required per point, and 6 S squared data transfers must be made to other computing nodes each time step. Note that each node is really S cubed virtual processors. As the grid points are crammed into the nodes, we can see whether the computation will be limited by processing speed, memory size, communication bandwidth, communication latency, communication overhead, or synchronization and scheduling overhead. If each computing node operates at, say, 128 megaflops, but only 64 megawords can be transferred to the processors, registers per second, then on this app, a node can really only carry out 64 megaflops, the limit or the real application performance of the node. Assume the network can send and receive data, say, at 10 megabytes per second, or there's a gap of 0.8 microseconds between each 8-byte word sent on the link with a link delay of, say, 10 microseconds, and the processor takes 1 microsecond of overhead to send or 1 microsecond to receive one word. This means it lost the opportunity to carry out 128 operations. Looking at the computational part of the grain, the T compute time here is 7s cubed divided by 64 megaflops, or 0.11s cubed microseconds. Let's look at whether the transmission is bandwidth or overhead limited. The gap is 4.8s squared microseconds, while overhead is 12s squared microseconds. Let's start by targeting half peak power so that T compute equals T overhead. At that point, S equals 109 and T compute is 32 megaflops. With a grid of 109 points, only 10 megabytes of memory are used. If each 32 megabyte memory is full of points, then S can increase to 160. T compute is now 0.44 seconds, T overhead is 0.3 seconds, and the resulting flop rate is 38 megaflops. With S at 160, then S cubed is 4 million. 28 million ops are carried out, and the grain is very long, 0.74 seconds. Now let's look at S is just 10. S cubed is 1,000, and T compute is 110 microseconds. The T overhead at this point is 1,200 microseconds. Efficiency drops to 10%, resulting in 5.4 megaflops. The long grain using the virtual processor approach allows scheduling and synchronization overhead to be ignored. According to our granularity definitions, this problem can be made at least wide area coarse grain. The graph summarizes the above results. Efficiencies of 10 to 90% are possible, resulting in 5.3 to 57 megaflops per node, as S is varied from 12 to 981. Runtime and memory grow with the cube of S. The line shows a 32 megabyte memory. The problem is defined without boundary values, unlike most real problems. To get a teraflop of real application performance implies ganging 22,128 megabyte computers running at 44.8 megaflops. At $30,000 per node, a computer would cost over $500 million. The problem illustrates three notions about parallelism. Amdahl reasoned that parallelism would be difficult because constant problem sizes were assumed. This is seen when S is only 10. By increasing the problem size, memory-constrained scaling was discovered to break Amdahl's law. To get to 90% efficiency requires 90 gigabytes per node, but 50% still takes 32 megabytes per node. A supercomputer, in comparison, will run at constant efficiency independent of problem size in this particular case. The Dash group at Stanford has posited time-constrained scaling. A user runs as large a problem as possible in the available time and takes the resulting efficiency. Given the difficulty of scaling, having a computer to exploit all grains of parallelism is critical. Let's look at just two dimensions of parallelism, granularity and user transparency. One dimension measures the granularity with a multi-program computer. The most granular are multiple independent programs that run in a time-shared system. These are infinitely parallel. Similarly, the transactions that go through multiple threads of a multi-process transaction processing system are all independent, as well as parallelism inherent in accessing one database. Unix has a number of facilities that allow processes to operate in parallel, including streams, pipes, and sockets. The finest granularity is within a parallel block and statements of a single job. A general-purpose computer must exploit all of these to be economically viable. The trick to applying parallelism is making it transparent to users. Ideally, no changes are required. Fully transparent scalar code is the most transparent since the compiler does all the work. The dusty decks from a supercomputer usually require changes, including enlarging the data set to match the idiosyncrasies of a particular computer. The least transparent is new algorithms and programs. New languages are even less transparent since they may require training new algorithms and new programs. With this overview, I want to turn to the components. Each node is an independent computer consisting of one or more microprocessors sharing a common memory. The nodes are connected via a switch. The difference between multiprocessors and homogeneous multicomputers is the hardware to name and control memory and how nodes communicate with other nodes. We'll first look at the nodes and interconnect network, and then the resources required by a few grand challenge problems and the challenge of balancing computers. The first is processing. This metric has evolved to be PAP, or peak advertising performance, measured in floating point operations per second, or flops. This is similar to MIPS, or meaningless instructions per second. Vector supercomputers use flops, but real users ask whether the processor to memory bandwidth can support the PAP in order to deliver real application performance, or RAP. Traditional supers load or store 3 words at the flop rate to run at PAP. Few workstations have memory bandwidth to run at PAP. A large memory is needed to scale up problems and for multiprogramming. 1 to 8 bytes per flop may be needed. 1994 workstations have 64 megabyte memories and extend typically to 512 megabytes and provide about 5,000 flops per dollar. Scalables built from micros must approach this. Historically, workstations and PCs have increased in performance at 60% per year and declined in price at almost 20% per year. If MPPs can improve this way, cost effectiveness can increase by a factor of 4 times 2 or 8 in 3 years. This is why unmodified workstations have to be used to build MPPs. Two processor architectures arise depending on whether one takes a computer science point of view with caching and wide word parallelism, or a supercomputer view using a compiler-controlled register and vector architecture. Both approaches require memory bandwidth to the processor. In 1993, the Fujitsu vector processor used by Mako delivers over 200 megaflops. Measuring a scientific processor with one number is impossible. Floating point spec marks attempt to measure technical workstations. PAP is meaningless, especially if you don't know the memory bandwidth. Peak LINPACK measures the performance that apps hope for. Livermore Fortran kernels provide an indication of the Livermore supercomputing workload. MPPs have negligible Livermore Fortran capacity when run together. Eventually, metrics will evolve for larger parallel problems. Note that 1993 workstations are near the 1976 Cray-1S supercomputer, but have better Fortran kernel performance because of their scalar capability. Micros are predicted to reach peaks of 800 and 2,000 megaflops by 1995 and the year 2000. In 1994, secondary and tertiary memories are evolving at rates comparable to microprocessors and memory. To properly balance fast computers, fast and large disks are required. The 60s rule of 1 MIPS implies 1 megabyte per second implies that a 100 gigaflop machine needs 12 gigabytes per second of I.O. If 1994 disks cost $1 per megabyte, and a terabyte would cost $1 million for 500, say, 2 gigabyte disks. These disks only hold 8 memory loads if the computer is 128 megaflop and 128 megabytes. Such a machine probably needs 2,000 disks, which at 250,000 hours between failures gets a failure every 125 hours. The good news is that 500 disks can supply data at 2.5 gigabytes per second, but the bad is that this is an appreciable fraction of a machine's switching capacity. The network that connects the distributed computers is the performance limiter if problems are less than medium coarse grain. Medium coarse grain problems carry out the 1,000 operations and have 1,000 operations of overhead and communication sloth that results in lost work to run at 50% efficiency. If an app runs at 100 megaflop rate for 10 microseconds per thread and takes 10 microseconds per thread for communication and synchronization scheduling overhead, the app would run at 50 megaflops and be medium grain. There is nothing sacred about 50%. 10% is an acceptable level for many apps, and this is still faster and more cost-effective than a supercomputer in many cases. A computation of 1,000 operation that takes 10 microseconds and running at 50 gigaflops in a node, say 50% of its PAP, can stand 5 microseconds of communication and other overhead and still deliver 10 gigaflops of computation. The important network parameters have been discussed. Bandwidth expressed as gap, the minimum transfer time between datum, latency, the time between send and receive, and overhead to send and receive a message measured at the process-to-process level. Overhead is the most critical. A nomogram is a good way to look at granularity. This is a graphical view of the granularity table we looked at before. On the left is processor speed in ops. In the middle, we see the message passing overhead and all the other overheads. And the grain length is on the right and measured in the number of ops per overhead grain. This shows why gigaflop supercomputer with a single physical memory that every processor can access is hard to beat. The grain size decreases significantly defined by having memory accessible in 100 nanoseconds, the time it takes for a super to carry out 100 operations. This figure shows the problem granularities for various networks using a 100 megaop processor. A typical MPP has 10 to 100 microseconds of overhead. A number of embarrassingly parallel and wide area network course problems have been solved using networks of computers. Much technical computing is embarrassingly parallel or infinitely parallel, such as exploring a design space, automatic test generation, analyzing independent data sets, and whatever. This nomogram compares the Cray C90 and Fujitsu VP supercomputers with the Cray T3D and the Fujitsu VPP 500 massively parallel computers. The Cray T3D uses 150 megahertz CMOS alpha micros that are interconnected using a network that guarantees latency to be less than 1 microsecond. This diagram shows why the Cray T3D is the first MPP able to challenge ordinary supers. Of course, the other reason is that the T3D is viewed and run as a multiprocessor and not a multicomputer. This figure shows a projection of grand challenge problems by DOE scientists that take 10 to the 18th ops or 1 million tera floating point operations and take varying memory resources. These problems take on the order of 3 months to run, assuming the MPPs run about 45 gigaflops. There's a wide variety of ratios of primary to secondary memory sizes of a factor of over 50,000 to 1. This wide variance really illustrates the need to have the users with a grand challenge adopt and fund them, and not having funding be from a computer center's perspective. Some problems are even suited to a PC, as you note. Now I'm going to speculate about the next decade of scalable computers. There are three independent lines of development. First, shared memory multiprocessors have evolved for 30 years as the mainline computer. Multiprocessors, multicomputers, or workstation and fast switches, Dash and the KSR1 demonstrate that this line can be continued and be indefinitely scalable. Second, workstations that communicate along a slow local area network by passing messages and share little or nothing are scalable. Their ability to handle a workload distributed among the nodes or a parallel task is nil. These deficiencies can be remedied. Workstations are clearly mainline. Although a close relative to LAN workstations, scalable multicomputers aren't mainline. To operate effectively, they must look like a multiprocessors. However, simply speeding up workstation network facilitates parallel processing and costs nothing because the nodes already exist. Technology evolves rapidly when everyone is going down the same path. CMOS is a good example. Multiprocessor servers are the most developed. They represent install capacities of hundreds of billions, and all manufacturers provide them. Similarly, LAN PCs and workstations are based on the millions of PCs. The decade-old multicomputer is special purpose that must either join the multiprocessor or workstation paths. Indeed, like a Turing machine, multi-computer software can simulate a shared memory multiprocessor. The virtual shared memory model was invented for this purpose. However, the issue is the simulation speed. As software is converted to hardware for performance, the question is how close can it come to being general purpose? Once software simulated floating point hardware, but a factor of 50 slower, now hardware always does floating point arithmetic. The test of survivability of a structure is its general purposeness or being able to carry out a wide range of tasks. Can the computer efficiently process a variety of jobs requiring a variety of processing, memory, and I/O resources? If it cannot, it will be relegated to a niche and ultimately die when more general purpose computers overtake it. This is why I believe multi-computers will either become ordinary workstations or shared memory multiprocessors. Multiprocessors have a single address space supported by hardware. Each multi-computer node has its own address space, and software overhead forms a common large global or virtual shared memory to support various programming models. Future 64-bit micros facilitate address generation to reduce this overhead. When a multiprocessor is used for parallel processing, data and programs are equally accessible to all processors. In multi-computers, programs and their data must be allocated among computers to minimize message passing overhead. Multiprocessors communicate data implicitly by directly accessing memory. Multi-computers explicitly pass messages requiring overhead that may or may not be hidden from the user by hardware or a compiler. Future multi-computers will be able to access all memory in other nodes. Multiprocessors provide the most efficient support for message passing by simply passing pointers as any shared memory system. Multi-computers move data using overhead software. Multiprocessors provide a single, sequentially consistent memory. When it exists in a multicomputer, memory consistency is controlled by overhead software. Since multiprocessors have a single, uniformly accessible memory and set of resources, the resources can be managed in a fungible fashion. This allows a single, time-shared operating system environment, such as Unix. Multicomputers run as an collection of independent, interconnected computers under control of a LAN-connected distributed workstation-like operating system. Multiple independent jobs simply aren't run across today's multi-computer environments dynamically, although it should be possible. A multiprocessor has a work queue that any processor can access. In a multi-computer, work, that is, programs and their data, is distributed among the computers on a static basis. As the load on the computers or clusters change, software must move the jobs. Distributed memory multiprocessors have an automatic mechanism, caching, to implicitly control and exploit locality. As a datum is accessed, it is automatically moved to another processor's memory. With multicomputers, every non-local access requires software for address translation, message passing accesses, and memory management to deal with data copies. A multiprocessor is inherently general purpose, that is, any collection of small to large and sequential to parallel programs can be operated on at any time. A multicomputer operates best in independent, statically determined partitions that run to completion on large batch parallel programs. If any of the nodes lack a facility, the system may have to stop in order to access other nodes. Any node in a multiprocessor may run any sized job from its shared virtual memory. In a multicomputer, a job size is limited by a node's memory size, and a computer is incapable of or ineffective at running a collection of large scalar programs that typifies perfectly parallel applications such as digital simulation. This facilitates running large dusty decks without necessitating complete rewriting. Being general purpose, Scalable multiprocessors can be applied to real-time, command and control, commercial transaction processing, and databases. Multicomputers are not general purpose for either applications or job size mix. They are best used in a large batch mode or as dedicated facilities. Multiprocessors take an evolutionary approach to parallelism by providing standard programming environments so that apps can be ported rapidly and incrementally tuned. Multicomputers have adopted two approaches. First, introducing new dialects of C and Fortran that require explicit statements to manage data, and second, explicit message passing that requires new programs and algorithms. Let's look at what the various structures offer. Supercomputers have two decades of tuned programs and knowledge about use, and a single memory to support fine granularity. Supers are clearly general purpose. Their factor of eight disadvantage in performance per dollar and PAP comes from using only slowly evolving expensive ECL technology versus CMOS micros. Supers run scalar code fastest, but their lead is decreasing. Scalable multiprocessors and multicomputers both have the advantage of high PAP and good performance per dollar that comes from using lots of micros. In early 94, the KSR computer and Stanford's Dash are the only scalable MPs. Cray Research and Convex have joined this line now. The KSR provides over an order of magnitude greater workload capacity based on the Livermore loops than the Cray C90, since anywhere from 1 to 1,088 independent jobs can reside in each processing element. Its 1088 processors deliver 6.6 megaflops for a total of 7 gigaflops versus the C90's 16 processors at 44 megaflops or 704 megaflops. The trick is to find 1,000 independent jobs if you want to maximize capacity utilization. The multicomputer's main flaws are poor scalar capability because they track workstation performance, inability to process an arbitrary workload, and time to port a new app. It should be noted that two kinds of multicomputers exist. Homogeneous is like workstations where every node is identical and runs the same operating system. Inhomogeneous, or SIMD like CM5, where one node runs the OS and controls execution in all others. For general purpose utility, all nodes must be identical. Workstations have all the advantages of scalable multicomputers with only increased latency. The economics are staggeringly in their favor since the nodes and network already exist. All that is needed is focus on the interconnect and withdrawing design support for special purpose multicomputers. With workstations compatibility, a user sees faster network operations, access to all network resources, new application opportunities, and ability to compute in parallel. Continuous scalability and evolvability occur. The biggest wins are not having to buy a special purpose computer. By having an enormous base or market, one could imagine a software industry. Workstations are the purest and simplest computer structure able to explicitly use microprocessors just as they are introduced. This lets learning curves reduce the node cost. These scale from a few dozen for a single work group to several thousand for a building and campus. The CRTs on the workstation solve a significant part of the I/O problem. Therefore, don't behead the workstations. When the problem doesn't parallelize, you still have a workstation, not pig iron. Lawrence Livermore Lab made the observation that it spends about three times as much on workstations that are 15% utilized as it does on supercomputers. By 1995, workstations with a PAP of 800 megaflops are 10 times the projected cost effectiveness of a super. Inherent in its spending, a lab would have 25 times more unused peak power in its workstations than its spatial centralized supercomputer or massively parallel computers. These workstations deliver five times the power of the super during the 15% of the time they are being utilized. An environment with 1,200 megaflop workstations has a free 200 gigaflop supercomputer that's idle most of the time. Thus, the impetus. All grain parallel processing from transaction processing to parallel Fortran and all forms of resource sharing, that is processors, memories, files, screens, windows, are possible, provided we target this goal. Potential performance should ideally increase linearly with system price. The difference in price performance for limited scalability computers is both a cost and price issue. Workstations are built in two orders of magnitude higher volume. This results in manufacturing learning curves that reduce their costs by a factor of 2 to 5. Similarly, higher priced servers cost more to sell and support. The important thing from the graph is that workstation clusters easily replace multi-computers. With a small increase in price to support a coherent memory, workstations can evolve to the multiprocessor. The worst cost performers are MPPs. They come out after workstations, are low volume, have a high cost penalty, and are not generation scalable. I see the parallelism challenge hinging on software economics. The enemy here is fast sequential processors and ordinary workstations. Therefore, we should exploit them. Hence, using idle in situ workstations is the key to exploiting parallel processing, unless you really add value like the Cray T3D. However, Cray could reattach the heads to those computers too. To get a software industry will require standard languages, libraries, environments, and paradigms. It is critical to have a small number, like one, programming paradigm despite machine differences. Clearly, the training continues as a number one limit to use and hence software. Finally, let's understand the economics of software and the cost of starting over because dusty deck programs have to be thrown out. Changing computing paradigms and necessitate throwing away large programs won't work. Programs cost up to $10 a line to produce and perhaps another $2 to $5 per year to enhance and maintain. While an evolved million-line program may not appear to be worth its $10 million cost, it's unclear how it gets replaced without large investments that even our federal government can't afford. Montre and Worlton make a conjecture about these programs. The degree of parallelism is proportional to the size of the problem, i.e. the scale, divided by the size of the program. Assuming a scaled parallel program that spends 99% of its time infinitely parallel can be speeded up by a factor of 8, that is the PAP ratio of supers and CMOS multicomputers. The serial part that takes 1% of the time runs a factor of 10 slower. The net result is still good, 4.5 speed up. However, if the serial part represents 95% of the code in a million line program, the conversion cost approaches the original cost. This argues that all machines need to be able to port existing apps and tune them, otherwise they are doomed because it takes too long for a machine to become productive. It also demonstrates the need for one language and environment. Today, MPP software is one of a kind because there can be no market for one of a kind computers or Fortran dialects. Many graduate student projects have demonstrated MPPs can be programmed and solve problems. Economic viability of software companies is related to market size, and this implies multiple platforms and customers who buy multiple copies. This comes back to a common programming model and environment. A technical software company with annual sales of $50 million might spend $10 million to develop and maintain software. When sold on mainframes, 1,000 copies per year are needed at $50,000 a copy. With workstations, the price can be reduced to $5,000, but 10,000 copies are needed. With MPPs, only 10 to 100 sites might exist to use the same software. The $50 million company would have to charge $500,000 to $5 million. This can be reduced by serving the market, say, with $5 million niche companies, but they still have to charge between $50,000 and $500,000 for an application. This argues for clear thinking about how a software industry can support massive parallelism, because it simply can't now economically. Certain failure is writing a program for a particular computer or a proprietary language. Another sure way to fail is writing on a yet-to-be-defined language. This language holds out false hopes that users and compilers can exploit or make up for machine idiosyncrasies. Federal funding of $1 billion plus per year does not assure massive parallelism will ever exist, even though it assures lots of hardware will be purchased. This is 0.07% of federal spending, representing about 6 times NSF spending in the computing directorate. It's about half of NSF's budget, too. By selecting a few suppliers to build and then purchase idiosyncratic state computers, users are denied access to a general marketplace. The free market is destroyed, and only state vendors can access the federally funded leading-edge early adopter market. The brutal market mechanism that weeds out vendors and helps understand and improve computers is stopped. The federal government might help the process by insisting on a few programming models and environments and a language. With one environment, some program portability might occur. Without this, no software market and no real use. Systems must be compared. A panel of objective people must review HPCC's progress and especially its future plans. I question whether a software industry will form in the midst of a program of funded chaos. Training is still the number one barrier to performance and use. This has been true since the first super and is essential for harnessing anything that has multiple instruction streams. While placing large machines at federal laboratories gives these labs a much-needed mission, they do little for training, understanding, and widespread use. Only universities and a software market can do this. Having 1,000-node machines lets a few users run very large problems, but 10 or 20 50-node computers at universities running at tens of gigaflops will solve the training, understanding, utilization, and software problem. Besides, the problems reside at universities. Based on progress to date, properly designed workstations represent a much better all-around investment for use, even if you're looking for teraflops. This is where I would like to see research and funding apply. I would like to encourage our federal bureaucrats to return to a user-based, demand-side, university-funding research policy when they want to help computing use and establish lasting industries. This allows free market, evolution of computing. If computer genetic engineering isn't illegal, it should be. Thank you.